There we go. Okay.
Oh, look at you.
As you were saying that, I'm like, I don't even know that. But I do.
Hey, Josh. Good to see you.
Hey, Josh.
Can you sit in the booth here today? Great. Thanks for coming.
Hey, Randy. I had a question about the blood draw. When's the next one?
Yeah.
welcome to worship. Welcome to those who are physically in the room, and also welcome to those who are worshiping with us online. We are with you, and you are with us, even though we can't both see each other. There is a lot going on in the life of the congregation. A reminder to those of you who are joining us online, we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper later in the service today. So if you don't have communion elements with you, take a moment to grab them during the opening music. Any kind of juice, any kind of bread, it is all blessed as we remember Jesus' last meal with his disciples. During the communion service, the liturgy, which is just a fancy word for all of the stuff that's not the sermon in the worship service, but liturgy actually means the work of the people. So we will be putting you to work. The entire communion prayer is responsive. So all the boldface, all the places where it says all, make sure that you respond and participate fully in the prayer. In family news, Allison is home from the hospital. Joyce is with her and the family, and she's doing well. So your prayers, continued prayers are appreciated. Keep Liz Roman and her family in your prayers. Her dad died after an extended period of poor health, and they're hanging in there, but prayers are always appreciated. This afternoon, we're going to have an enjoyable time out in the parking lot. We're going to have a drive-in Christmas carol party. We have song sheets, we've got music leaders, the elves have been busy. I saw some really cool looking goodie bags for the folks who end up coming. Tell your neighbors, tell your friends. It's a chance to get out. The sun's going to be shining. It's going to be a nice day. We've never tried this before, but hey, we've done a lot lately we've never tried before. So, I tell everybody we're making it up as we go along. A reminder that the nominating committee is engaged in a search for elders and deacons. If you do get a call from one of them, prayerfully consider serving in that capacity for the congregation. Our youth are going to be getting together today. If you're out there and you can hear me putting in a plug, bring a friend. From 1 to 2:30, they're going to be gathering in the gym making gingerbread houses. And I think that brings us up to date. Let's quiet our hearts and listen to what God has to say for us in music.
So today's serving as our music leaders, we've got our worship band, and we've got Debbie Dennis leading us in the hymns. And the theme of today is the humility of Jesus. So the songs we've chosen reflect that.
Thank you.
Dear God,
we thank you for the
example of Jesus, who bowed his head in humble obedience and endured the cross on our behalf. May our knees bow before him and our tongues confess him Lord of all. Amen.
As we gather our hearts together, let us be called to worship by reading responsively from the prophecy in Isaiah chapter 40. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God."
Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
A voice says, says, cry out.
And I say, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Constancy is like the flower of the field.
The grass withers. The flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass.
The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Let us worship God.
Change us because
God so loved the world that Jesus, God's only Son, came into the world in order to redeem everyone who believes, hear and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever, world without end. Amen. And so when we're forgiven, it brings peace into our hearts, it puts us at peace with God, and it lets us forgive one another and be at peace with one another. So take a moment, those of you who are here in the room, look around, wave past the peace. If you're worshiping with us at home, we send the peace to you as well. If you're worshiping with somebody, give them a hug, share God's peace. And if you're watching this without anyone else in the room, know that we are with you and God is with you as well. The Christmas season does bring out the child in all of us. And when we're on a journey, anybody who's ever traveled with kids, or if you've been a kid and remember, one of the most common questions that the kids will ask is, are we there yet? Well, today we lit the second candle on the Advent wreath. Are we there yet? Not yet. Got a whole 2.5 weeks more to go until we celebrate the coming of Jesus at Christmas. And at times like this, it is tough to be patient. 2 whole weeks? You gotta be kidding. And typically, mom and dad are less than helpful. They just say, you have to be patient. And the child in all of us says, patient? Bah humbug. Well, a long time ago, the first Christians had that problem too. When Jesus was here on earth, he told his disciples that he was going to come back and return for them. And they would live with him in God's glorious kingdom. Well, that's something really to look forward to, but the trouble is, he did not tell them when it was going to happen. Well, they figured a couple weeks, next month, maybe next year at the outside. But then the weeks turned to months, and the months turned to years and decades, and still, Jesus had not come back. And the early church, the first few generations of Christians, got impatient and they wondered, are we already come back? You said you were coming, where are you? And 2,000 years later, we're still wondering that. And so in the early days of the church, the leaders wrote letters and sent them around to the different worshiping communities. And some of the leaders wrote letters to encourage these communities and say, hang in there. We don't know when Jesus is coming back, but be patient and wait and continue to live your lives as Jesus has called you to do. And one of those letters we're going to read in a part of in a moment. And the writer says, be patient with God because God's being patient with us. Interesting way to look at it. But when this return happens, it's going to be the big event. And it's what everybody's been hoping for. And it will be worth the wait. We're not there yet. We have to be patient, knowing that the Lord's coming again. So every year, we celebrate Advent, we celebrate Christmas. That helps us remember that Jesus is with us now, will be with us forever, even though he hasn't come back in person yet. And so while we wait, we do the best we can to live the way he wants us to live and help one another and be kind to other people. Let's pray. Dear Lord, it's so hard to be patient. We want Christmas to be here. We want everyone to love one another. We want the hungry to be fed. We want the homeless to have shelter, and we want everybody to live in peace. Help us be patient. Help us also follow you and make the world a better place so that these things will happen. We pray this in your name. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. As we get ready to hear God's word for us this morning, please join me in the prayer for illumination. Holy God, wake us up if we are asleep. Calm the storm within us if we are overwhelmed, and hold us fast if we are running. Whatever it takes, open our hearts and minds to hear your voice as you speak your life-changing word to us. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Our first reading comes from the second letter of Peter, the third chapter. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. And then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire? But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth, where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord salvation.
How many kings
And it came to include making sure the house was ready for me when I get back. Our reading this morning from Mark shows John the Baptizer telling people to do some of this in anticipation of the first coming of Christ. He quotes from the prophet Isaiah, talking about preparing the way of the Lord and making a straight path. This was a famous part of Jewish religious literature, so the listeners would have gone on in their own minds to think about lifting up valleys and making the hills low and leveling out the uneven ground, turning the rough places into a plain. Of course, nowadays, if you're a music geek like me, you hear Handel in the background every time you read those words. But it's a reference his listeners would have recognized. How? And it referred to something we may not realize, but how people prepared for the visit of an important person during ancient times. Road conditions between towns were not good. You had desert, you had wilderness, you had bandits. And so if somebody important was coming, they would send a messenger ahead to let a town know. And then the road crews would go out and they would fill in the holes and they would chase away the bandits and they would make sure that the path was smooth for the important visitor. And so this is what John was doing. When he appeared in the wilderness, he preached what's described in our reading as a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Now, a lot of times when we hear the word repentance, we only scratch the surface and think, oh yeah, it means I'm sorry. But it's a whole lot more than that. It means breaking out of whatever destructive cycle of sin that we're in, changing our mindsets and actually walking in a new direction. The word in its original language has the sense of almost a physical turning around and going another way. So it's not just something we feel, but it's something that we do. And if we look at how this reads in some of the other translations, which is always a fun thing to do, it helps flesh this out, this baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. So if we look, say, in the New Living Translation, they translate this as a baptism to show they had turned from their sins and turned to God. Common English Bible says it was a baptism to show they were changing their hearts and lives. And in the Message paraphrase, it's called a baptism of life change. So we can see that John's not just asking people to be sorry for the state they're in. He's challenging them to change their lives. John invited people to turn around, to take a new path away from sin in order to be ready for the coming of Jesus. And so he gave the people of Judea a choice. You can stay stuck in your crooked life path, or you can turn and go another direction and find the path that is straight. And a lot of people, many, many people, decided to take this first step. They went out to see this John, this strange guy, dressed all weird, clothed with camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist. Yeah, it's interesting because John wasn't telling people they should do what he's doing. You know, he wasn't asking them to all go eat locusts and grasshoppers and dress weird. But he did promise to put them in touch with Jesus, the one, he says, is more powerful than I, the one, he says, will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Apparently, folks were hungry for this kind of life change because they flocked. They came out in droves to see John. There was this desperate desire to break out of their self-destructive, crooked paths and move in a new direction. Mark reports that people from the whole Judean countryside and all of Jerusalem were going out to him to be baptized in the river and confessed their sins. And so when they accepted John's baptism for the forgiveness of sins and for repentance, this helped the people who were hearing the message get their internal house in order for this journey, to be ready when Jesus came, to be open to Jesus' message, to believe when he came and when they saw him. And each generation up until today always has that same choice. As we get ready for our Advent journey, part of the process is putting our spiritual houses in order, turning to God, asking God to change our hearts and change our lives. Now, one of the interesting things we get from Mark's account is the first coming of Jesus is announced, but not by announcing his birth. The people who heard John preach were put on notice that King is coming soon, but they had an opportunity to get themselves ready. And then, of course, we've got the always the Advent tension of celebrating the birth and looking forward to the return. And this, you know, the second coming is foretold lots of places, but it's not going to be specifically announced the way Mark announced this is the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. When we celebrate the Lord's Supper in a little bit, we'll proclaim that great mystery of faith, and we'll all say, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And yet, as we prepare for this Advent journey, year after year after year, I venture to guess that for most of us, there's a lot more emphasis on getting ready for Christmas than there is on preparing for the second coming of Christ. The images we have for Christmas, rightly or wrongly, are warm and fuzzy and comfortable. The second coming? Eh, not so much. The images in the Bible are dramatic, potentially scary, depending on how you read these various passages. Jesus himself used vivid imagery to describe his return. Just in Matthew 24, he says his return will be like a bolt of lightning, or a flash flood, or a thief in the night. After Jesus ascended into heaven, the angels told the gaping disciples that he would come back in the same way you saw him go. When Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, he described it by saying, the Lord himself with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven. So it's clear that Christ's return will be sudden and unexpected whenever it happens. Paul and Peter also use this thief in the night image. But it doesn't mean we have to be caught unprepared. A lot of what we read in the New Testament, especially in the letters, was written to help the followers of Christ prepare for his return. Like I said, back then they thought it was going to happen any minute. Certainly within their lifetime. So they had this constant sense of urgency, this eager expectation. Paul was under the impression it was going to happen so soon that when he wrote to the Corinthians, he said, don't even bother getting married. You know, if you're married, stay married, but if you're not married, don't bother getting married because this is going to happen any minute. And here we are. 2,000 years later, it hasn't happened yet. So how do we go about being prepared? What do we do as we live our lives during this in-between ambiguous time that we don't know how long it's going to last? Peter tells us we start by packing patience in our Advent suitcases. In the part of the chapter leading up to what we read, he acknowledged that people were laughing at the believers and mocking them because the return of Christ had not taken place the way they said it was going to happen, the way they were anticipating. Peter says, don't worry. Be patient with God. Because the delay is a sign that God's being patient with us. And when we pack patience, it suggests two things we don't need to do. One is, let's not bother trying to predict when this is going to happen. And let's not speculate about the details of how it's going to happen. Because both of these really are pointless exercises that don't add anything to our daily life of faith or how we live in the world as it exists. To be absolutely blunt, speculation about the rapture and Armageddon and the millennium and the tribulation, that's all bogus, pure and simple. Some people love throwing these words around, usually because they're trying to sell lots of books or something. But what do we need to know? Christ will come again, for real, in person. We don't know when, and it really doesn't matter. In the meantime, we're called to advance the kingdom of God, to live our lives in a way that shows that we've put our houses in order and that we are ready. And this abstract belief that Christ will come again really isn't worth much if it doesn't have any effect on how we live our lives from day to day. If we just stay on those crooked paths, what's the point? But we can be ready. We can look at what Jesus told us about taking care of the world and taking care of one another, taking care of those who can't take care of themselves. That gets us on the straight path. And when we're on the straight path, then we can say, come, Lord Jesus. May we all have our houses in order so we're ready for you. Amen. Just a reminder that out in the narthex, we have where you can leave your offering, where you can leave your pledges of time and talents for next year. Your gifts are appreciated. There are things happening behind the scenes, ways that we're trying to find new ways to reach out to the community. So continue with the gifts. It is most important. So as we think about the fact that we are giving back to God, let us pray. Gracious God, we give our gifts in love and thanksgiving for all you've given us. Let our giving be not the end point, but rather the beginning. Let our gifts of love and gratitude travel where we do not and cannot at the moment. May they make pathways of hope and peace where it's lacking. We ask all this in the name of your Son, Christ our Lord. Amen. So as we prepare to celebrate the Lord's Supper, if you're at home, make sure you have your elements ready. If you're here and have either brought or picked up bread and the fruit of the vine, we can get that ready. And like I said, our entire the invitation, the prayer, all of that is going to be responsive. If you're following the bulletin that was sent out, I think there's an extra line that doesn't actually belong there. So if it looks like I skipped something, that was on purpose. God does invite us to the table. We are the people of God. So come now and gather with joy around the table of the Lord.
We come with joy and humility. We remember that Christ died for us, and we remember with joy that Christ was raised from the dead.
Christ calls us to take up our cross of love and to follow him. He He came to serve, not to be served.
We come to this table now to be served by him. We will lead with new power and strength to serve one another.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts and your hands to receive God's blessing.
We open wide our arms to be blessed as children of God.
Make your hearts tender and welcome God's forgiveness.
We open our ears to hear God's words for us. We lift up our voices and praise God.
Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you.
Let the heavens be joyful and the earth be glad.
We bless you for creating the whole world, for your promises to your people Israel.
And for Jesus Christ, in whom your fullness dwells.
Born of Mary,
he shared her life.
Eating with sinners,
he welcomes us.
Guiding his children,
he leads us.
Visiting the sick,
he heals us.
Dying on the cross,
saves us.
Risen from the dead,
he gives new life.
Living with you,
he prays for us.
With believers everywhere, we proclaim the great mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With thanksgiving, we take this bread and this cup and proclaim the death and resurrection of our Lord.
Receive our sacrifice of praise.
Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that this meal may be a communion in the body and blood of our Lord.
Make us one with Christ and with all who share this feast.
Unite us in faith, encourage us with hope, inspire us to love, that we may serve as your faithful disciples until we feast at your table in glory.
We praise you, eternal God, through Christ your word made flesh, in the holy and life-giving Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after he gave thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then in the same way, he took the cup. And he said, this cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. And so every time we eat this bread and every time we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Taste and see that the Lord is good, and enjoy the meal.
Thank you.
Let us continue in prayer. Holy God, you sent your Son to warm the darkness with light. We pray for all those who cannot see the light because they're afraid or because they're in too much pain, whether it's physical or spiritual or emotional. May all people know the healing power of your word, your light, and your grace. In this meal, Lord, you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. You have fed us with the bread of life. You've renewed us for your service. Help all of us who have shared Christ's body and received his cup to be faithful disciples, so that our daily living may be part of the life of your kingdom, so that our love will be your love, reaching out into the life of the world. We pray these things through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. So I'm going to finish.
Click share.
Oh, finish, yeah.